No, it's a pleasure for me to introduce the first lecture of Professor Katz, which is about introduction to vertex algebras, what some vertex algebras, and integral Hamiltonian PDE. Yes.
The purpose of this lecture is to introduce the basic concepts which will be used in other courses for a more specific subject. The main character of this lecture is our vertex algebras. And so I won't assume that everybody knows what it is, so I will begin from the very beginning. I think I need the mic.
I don't know.
Is it okay or better with mic? It's okay.
By the way,
look it up.
This
microphone
is working.
Do you prefer with microphone or without?
Like now.
At least I can hear.
Yeah, no. Some problem with
it.
Okay. Usually it takes a long introduction in order to get even at the definition because it's a rather complicated topic. But in fact, it's very easy to explain it, and I decided to give the definition of vertex algebra in the first 5 minutes of my talk. So vertex algebra is an algebra, but not quite a usual algebra. It's an algebra where the product depends on a parameter, which is denoted by Z. And so vertex algebra is a special case of some kind of more general algebras, which is, I would call them Z algebra, so the answer is terrible. But I must say that the name vertex algebra is as terrible as well. Actually, once Borchers confessed to me that he called them vertex algebra because it's so stupid that he hopes that the name will be changed to Borchers algebra. So, a definition. We see algebra. Is a vector space. With a bilinear product, with values now, a few of the denotes the formal Lorentz series with coefficients in V. In other words, the finitely many negative powers of Z are allowed in any number of positive powers. And actually, for your convenience, here I introduced a notation which everybody knows, but just to remind yourself, in particular, this is the notation that I use. Okay, what does that mean? It means that the product is denoted by A, C applied times B, where A and B are elements of B, And if, since it's Laurent series, so it can be written sum, and notation is usually the following. And the fact that that it is so it's supposed to be formal Laurent series, so which means that A and B is zero for n sufficiently large. Now the operator of left multiplication in this algebra. A is the sum with minus 1, where A n are endomorphisms. So this is so this is a definition, and the logic definition. So it's just explanation and notation, which is used. This is an N divided. It just means bilateral series, infinite in both directions. And this is corresponds to the last notation in the collector. Of course, a big difference between the first four and the last one is that in the case when U is an algebra, for example, the case U, then the first four are also algebras. You can multiply them and you won't encounter any divergences. But the last one is not an algebra. You cannot multiply two bilateral series. You get divergences. I'll talk more about formal distributions a little later. Moreover, it's not only formal distribution. It is a quantum field. Which exactly means that in addition, there is a property that AM like B is zero for n sufficiently large. Okay, so this is what is what kind of algebras that we will consider. In this series, there is also an analog of a unit allowed. Unit element of a zero. Mm-hmm. Peter Huberta. Which is tempting to denote by one, but this is denoted by the vacuum sign. Such that the following two properties hold. First, the quantum field corresponding to the vacuum is just identity. It simply means that if you take the vacuum and take dense product with any element A, you get delta M minus 1. You get the times A. You get back A if N is equal to minus 1, and you get 0 as a vector. So this indeed is an honest identity element. For minus first product, and it just gives zero for all other. And secondly, if you multiply the other way around, if you take UZ and then you get the formal power. The constant term should be that A plus Z of course each coefficient will be some linear operator applied to A. For Z I will denote it by A plus the higher power.
Greater equal than minus one. Greater equal than minus one.
Yes. Another definition quantum field is translation covariant. see the commutator. Let's see this one here. This is a derivative. Of course, derivative is just if you have this A of Z, you get differentiate the use of the whole C to the minus A. And this is equivalent to saying that the commutator of T is An equals minus N A M X for the whole kind of. Okay, let me introduce too many definitions without any statements. It's always dangerous because people tend to forget them. But let me just move the sample statement. If A of Z is a translation covariant remember, pi to field is just operator of left multiplication
of a unit of C.
Then one can describe completely what happens if you apply A of D to the left. The answer is that it is P to Z applied to the statement. Which is, of course, sum. Both sides satisfy the differential equation if you differentiate the right-hand side, you get just t times this. So it indeed satisfies this equation. And the right-hand side satisfies the initial condition. When z equals to 0, you get a. What about the left-hand side? If you put z equals to 0, then you get a from the definition of the unit of the unit area. Now, if you differentiate, it amounts to differentiating A of Z. But since it's translation invariant, it's equal to T A of Z applied to the right hand minus A of Z T see the planets. I forgot to say, yes, maybe I should put here the remark. By definition is A minus
-2.
A minus 2.
Vacuum minus 2.
What?
Vacuum minus 2, vacuum. Not A, vacuum.
Sorry. Yeah, we know that T applied to A. Yeah, we know that T applied to A for any A is equal to A minus 2 applied to the vacuum. So T applied to the vacuum is vacuum minus 2 vacuum. But by the properties of the vacuum, it follows that it is equal to zero. Okay, so T applied to the vacuum is zero, so you get T applied to A of the vacuum. And so we obtain both the left hand side. So the left hand side also satisfies this differential equation. And the initial condition when z is equal to zero is again A. So this completes the problem. This kind of typical argument in this theory, when you want to prove an identity, you check that both sides satisfy, that both sides are formal power series, that's important. That both of them satisfy the same equation with the same initial condition. But this theorem is true on differential equations, that just if you have given initial conditions, then all other equations are recursively computed by using the differential equation. So the theorem of existence of uniqueness of differential solution of differential equations over formal power series is a completely trivial thing. Okay, so this is the first now I can define what the vertex algebra is. Vertex algebra is a unit of C algebra such that the following two properties hold. First, all quantum fields are such that all quantum fields are translation covariant.
Let me repeat the reminder again. Yeah, sometimes I write this and sometimes zero.
And second, all specs of quantum fields are open, which means that if you take commutator of A of Z and Z of W, you get something like bilateral series in C and W, which I will call forward distribution into variables. And the property is that it's almost commutative. If you multiply it, if you multiply it by a power, sufficiently large power, non-negative powers, then it gets. Spent 5 minutes, but it's a little longer. 8 minutes. So this is the definition. And this is the main object of all lectures in this period. So this is so I will not spend time on explaining how it comes from physics, because both notions of translation covariance and of quantum field and of locality comes from physics, from the so-called Weidman axiom. But you can read the explanation of how it is related to real quantum field theory in my book, Bert's Algebra for Beginners. Is the very first chapter. But of course, the extreme. People often ask the following natural question: why you cannot cancel it? It's only means that just A of Z and B of W commute. And you will see why, because there is the thing, remarkable thing, which is called delta function, which tells you that you cannot cancel. But this will be explained in a few minutes. But first of all, let me consider this simplest example. Of a commutator. Means that all n a b are equal to zero. So you have to say what is a of z times b. For that, take V to be a unit of commutator associated algebra. with the derivation.
Which has been not breaking.
Such a thing is called differential out. Then P is the vertex algebra. And you remember, vertex algebra is a unital Z algebra. So you have to say what is the Vatian vector. Of course, everybody expects the Vatian vector to be the identity element. And what is the Z-vector multiplication? A of Z. You do the form. You take E plus the ZT applied to A. So you get the series. And then this series multiply that we stated as the first instances. Check that this is a vertex algebra. Slightly more difficult part, though also very easy. Using Lemma 1, prove that these are all. So in other words, commutative vertex algebra is the same thing basically as the differential algebra. So that is really nothing. And really the new stuff begins when you begin talking about non-commutative vertex algebra. But to construct a non-commutative vertex algebra is hard. It's less elementary. Okay, there is one more simple remark. Is it is the algebra? Is the vector space with a bilinear product? integer. For example, in the example, A and B was 0 if n is a nullity field, and A minus n minus 1 B was t to the n applied to A over n factorial, and so all of them I express in terms of this, of the product on the neutral part. But then we're in kind of classical realm. So we can say what is a homomorphism, isomorphism. What is subalgebras? Ideals. Which is the standard thing. Homomorphism is a linear map which is compatible with all Lens products. Subalgebra is subspace which is closed under n product and so on. So I can use this terminology just in the usual tradition of it. Now another remark. This is terminology which comes from physics. The map given the unit of physiology. The map denoted by Fs, which associates the quantum field A of Z, is constantly with A of Z applied to the vacuum and 2Z plus Z. Which is actually A minus 1 applied to the vacuum. It's called the field state principle. The opposite map, state field correspondence, which associates to any element A in E, the corresponding quantum field A of E, is called the state field now, again, I'm trying to state the material results as early as possible, but the proof will be given later. Now I can state the first fundamental theorem. So the theorem allows to construct non-commutative exergents. Very easy. But it takes some time to put it. Okay, so what does the theorem say? Basically, it says that if you have only kind of partial data of the whole data of a vertex algebra, then it can be uniquely extended to a vertex algebra. But this partial data is much easier to check.
Okay, what is partial data?
Let me
be a vector space. Is a non-zero vector. With endomorphism. Let's minimize again what it is. It's so AN psi endomorphisms. And AN applied to a vector, phi zero for N. So we have this data which is a quadruple, a vector space, a non-zero vector, an endomorphism, and a collection of quantum. Suppose that the following properties hold.
Is your collection finite?
Not necessarily, it could be. The first is called vacuum property. Namely that T applied to the vacuum is zero. The second property is translation covariance. Let me remind you, it means that T, but only for this field, this AJ of Z is equal to Z. Third locality, again, only for this field, namely Z minus W. And finally, completeness. Which says that if you apply all coefficients of the field to the vacuum vector, so A, J1, and 1, A, J2, and 2, etc., A, J, S, and S, and if you apply it to the vacuum, so you get some vectors of the space. So all these vectors span the vector space. So these are the conditions. Then let F maximum be the set of all translation providing quantum fields. Such that A of Z and AJ of Z is a local pair for all. Again, local pair means that if it is a commutator A of Z with AJ of W, multiplied by some power Z minus W, gives Z. Then the map field state correspondent for F maximum. Given by A of Z goes to A of Z Is projective. And the product and RSP with the structure with vacuum vector. And the translation was right there. Now, why this is called the extension theorem? That obviously F is contained in F max. Because all paths from F are local, so the second problem. And all elements of from F are translation provided. These are just properties of the second to the third. That is why it's called, hence the name extension. So we extend the partial collection of quantum fields to the maximum possible. So obtain the structure of the there is one little hole in this definition, namely the question is why we can put here z equals zero. Because it doesn't say anywhere in the definition of or it does. Yeah, because it's a unit of because it's a unit of the algebra, so A of Z applied to the vacuum is a form of power series, so you can proceed this. But if the properties are, so the theorem formulation is complete. But so far it is not clear why it is. Why it is even a Z algebra, let alone why it is a vertex algebra. But the fact that it is Z algebra follows from the following lemma. So today I will not prove the theorem, but I will prove one lemma, and the rest I will prove next time. So this is. So let me vector space. Then, for any translation covariant to survive is formal power series. Then it has the following form, A of C equals A minus 1. White is the formal power series. So we have to prove that An applied to the vacuum is zero for all non-negative integers. But we know that that it is since it is a quantum field, we know that An applied to the vacuum is equal to zero for all n greater or equal than some n n. But we also know, so I just wrote down that A of Z is a quantum field. But we also know that it is translation covariant quantum field. So this translation covariant quantum field says that T with A n permitted is equal to minus A n A n minus 1 for all. Apply both sides to the vacuum. But since T kills the vacuum, we get the T applied to An vacuum is equal to minus A N A N minus 1. Mm-hmm. So for n positive, a n minus 1 applied to vacuum being non-zero implies that a n, or maybe the other way around, a n actually completes the proof, because we know that an applied to the vacuum is zero for n sufficiently large, and using this you can go down in n until you hit n. But now by lemma 1, so this proves that it's a formal power series, but now by lemma 1, A of C applied to the vacuum is E to the CT applied to A, whereby A yes, now I remembered one thing which I forgot to ask. I was asked to write notes of this lectures, and of course it would be much easier for me if somebody takes notes. Because people are taking notes, but if they would be taking notes with some purpose, maybe they will write it in a more legible way. Please raise your hands who would like to write notes. Okay, I would like to have two people, or even more. Jasper, what about me?
I write notes for the first.
What?
I would be in next week, but I
can
write notes for the first
half. Okay, all right. Okay, so we have now three writers, so hopefully all the guests will produce something. I was given lectures a couple of years ago, and unfortunately I had only one writer who was a very talented mathematician, and I thought that he was also a talented writer, but it turned out to be false.
It's only one other.
So sometimes it is not very bad. All right, so let's make a break. What about until, say, 4 or 5? Rather somewhat implicitly, the vertex algebras were introduced in the first papers on conformal field theory as a notion of state field correspondence by Belavin, Polyakov, and Zamarodko. And the first formal definition was introduced by Borchardt in 1986. but in a very complicated way with some very complicated identities. And it's really quite remarkable that such a simple definition, which is completely conceptual in the spirit of quantum field theory, suffices in order to derive from the first principles all those complicated identities. And I will explain how it is done. Now, the extension theorem, some versions of it have been known before. In my book, there is a kind of weaker version of it. But this is really the strongest version, and it was proved in our joint paper with Alberto De Soria about maybe 10 years ago. Also, these assumptions of the extension theorem are very reminiscent of the Whiteman axioms. Which was introduced in the 50s by Arthur Whiteman. In particular, he introduced this important notion of quantum field, that it is an operator value distribution on the space-time. And this idea is reflected here in the definition of the quantum field. But these assumptions are more or less Whiteman axiom, except that they, of course, it's a four-dom or multi-dimensional quantum field theory, and instead of this one operator, one which is representation of one-dimensional algebra, one takes a representation of the Poincaré algebra, and states very similar axioms like translation invariance, vacuum axioms, and so on. So it's very much inspired by physics. My next remark is that I cheated a little bit in my first lecture in the following point, that usually by vertex algebra one means vertex super algebra. So let me make it as a remark. Namely, and I think that in the lectures, probably in post lectures, it will be used in this slightly more general setup, because what's important is the example of fermions, which I will introduce in this lecture. Namely, V is a vector superspace, which simply means that it is decomposed into direct sum of two subspaces. This is called even subspace. This is called the vector superspace. The vacuum vector is even. T preserves its decomposition. Yeah, the notation 0 bar 1 bar specifies that 0 bar 1 bar form the group Z mod 2V. And then the product is Z-mod to Z-traded, meaning that if you have product of A alpha and B beta, it's again lies in V, but more precisely it lies in V alpha plus beta. And finally, the commutator is understood in the super sense. Namely, if you have A of Z B of W, what does it mean? It means A of C B of W. Usually one takes just minus B of W A of Z without if it go. Yes, usual space you get when V is equal to V zero, namely the odd part is zero. The commutator is defined, there is a sign correction. If A of Z, if this has parity alpha and this has parity beta, then here you have sign minus 1 to the alpha beta. Yeah, so this is only, I suppose most of you know this thing, it is a very kind of common in particular commutativity in the super sense. Means that A B equals minus 1 to alpha beta. And our statement that commutative vector, yes, and commutative in example, for example, all commutative vertex. Still, one almost never says vertex super algebra, still one says vertex algebra. But not that super algebra is obtained from the differential super algebra. Associative unit of super algebra with derivation, which is commutative in this sense. So it is a very simple extension, but sometimes a lot of new interesting examples appear when you move from Lie algebras to this. So as I said, I will prove the extension theorem next time. Before proving it, one needs some preparatory material. Namely, as I explained, quantum field is actually a formal distribution with values in this space of endomorphisms of a vector space. So the next thing which I will explain today is calculus of formal distributions. It's a very simple general formalism. So the definition. Now that we have the definition 6. Let U be a vector space. A formal distribution. A of Z is an element of infinite in both directions series. The same distribution can be written in many ways. One can write, for example, A of Z equals sum A n Z to the n, where A of n are a n's are element vectors, just generating series of sequence of vectors. And one defines residue A of z dz to be equal to the coefficient of z input, which is a minus 1. But of course, another way of writing, which we used before, which actually goes back to the first works on conformal field theory, is A of Z is equal to sum. That's why one puts n in parentheses, if you want to decompose it. So a n with parentheses and a n without parentheses are related by I'm afraid to make a mistake, so I don't write how they related. Where why such one of the reasons why it is a natural way to write is that a n is just residue of z to the n of A of Z, Z to the N dz. So why it is called formal distribution? Not that A of Z is a linear function on the space of test functions. Which I take the Laurent polynomials. Namely, if you take A of Z, then its value on a test function phi of Z Is it good to raise it to A of Z, C of Z, DZ? If you remember, you cannot multiply two infinite in both direction series, but you can multiply such a series by Laurent polynomial, because you can always multiply by Z to the N, and also, of course, by finite linear combination of such. So, in fact, this bilateral series is a module of a Laurent polynomial. And it's not difficult to show that that it is a space of all formal distributions. If all linear functions on the space of Laurent polynomials are obtained in this way from some A of Z from Z. That is why it is called the formal distribution.
You mean linear functions with value where? Linear function with value.
This value is with the vector space, not VU. So that's why it's sometimes we say, in order to specify, say U value. And similarly, we define formal distribution in two variables, to use ZW, less than the space of the C universe W. And it is sum A M N. Here is a formal distribution, U value distribution, in two variables. An important definition is definition 7. Such a formal distribution A of ZW is called local. Ну, very natural. If Z minus W to the n, A of ZW is zero for some non-negative integer. The most important example of a local distribution into variables, actually F value, is a delta formal delta function. It is the following thing. It looks a little unnatural, but you will understand in a moment why it is a very natural thing. It's sum over n, z to the minus n minus 1, double to the n, n over z. So it's not a function, it's really a distribution. But in fact, it is a kind of difference of two functions, which is consistent with the usual delta function in analysis. Namely, so we want to prove that it's local. Of course, in principle, you can multiply and see that it is local. Since it is easy to check that z minus w times delta z w is equal to 0. So this example shows that you cannot cancel z minus w. Delta z w is not 0, it's an infinite series, bilateral series. But it becomes 0 when you multiply it by z minus w, which you can check directly. But there is another smarter way to check it. Namely, one can write delta ZW is a difference of expansion of this series and expansion of the same series, but in different domains. So where IZW denotes expansion in the domain modulo z greater w, and iwz greater than z. Let me just write it why. If you have one of z minus w, you can write it as z inverse times 1 divided, 1 minus w divided by z. But modulus of w over z is less than 1, so you can expand it into a geometric progression. So equal to sum z w to the n, z to the minus n minus 1, for n greater or equal than 0. So it is expansion when modulus z is greater than modulus w. And IWZ of the same thing is easy to compute, that is equal to sum n less than this minus sign of the same thing. And this gives you this form. A useful formula in general is the following, that if you take nth derivative, it's even more general. Nth derivative of the delta function and divide by n factorial. If you differentiate these two formulas for the delta function, differentiate this. n times by w. You find that this is equal to izw 1 divided by z minus w 2 plus 1 minus iwz n plus 1. And differentiating this expansion, you get that's equal to sum n to z j to z, j choose n, w to j minus 10, z to z minus j minus 1. Okay, so you get this one. Which is very useful in making computations as a data function. Properties of the data function. Yeah, let me, I don't remember which numbering I used before, but at least in my notes, it's formula 4. First property is that if you take z minus w to the m, times nth derivative of the delta function divided by n factorial gives you exactly the same thing but with shifted lower derivative. Now it gives you dw to the n minus m delta dw divided by n minus m factorial. It's if n greater than n, and it will zero if m is greater than. Which of course shows that any derivative of the delta function is local. Because multiply the sufficiently large power of z minus w, you get zero. So this is the first property. The second property is that delta is symmetric in ZW, which you can check directly. And the third is that the derivative by Z of the delta function is equal to negative derivative of W of the delta function, which also very easy. And finally, fourth, which is also checked as three fourths. Why it is called delta function? Because if you take A of Z delta of ZW multiply by delta of ZW, it is the same as A of W multiply by delta ZW. Therefore, if you take residue A of Z delta ZW Z, you get A of W. Because the residue of the delta function is equal to 1. Okay. And then using this very simple facts about the delta function, we can prove the key theorem of the formal distribution calculus, which is the decomposition theorem. Which is also a very elementary theorem. That's very useful. Any local formal distribution. Can be decomposed in terms of the derivatives of delta function. In a finite sum. Sum, so J runs over finitely many values. C, J of W can be decomposed uniquely. J is derivative of the delta function divided by J factorial. Moreover, there is a simple explicit formula for Cj of W. It is a residue. A z w, z minus w, plus j, d. Maybe I should say quickly what is the proof so that you don't think that it's something very complicated. First, multiply both sides of 5 by z minus w. Using properties of the delta function, we obtain formula 6. Which first proves uniqueness, and secondly proves that coefficients should be given by this formula. Now it remains to prove that any local formal distribution can be decomposed in this form. So far we didn't really use locality. For that, for existence, consider B of ZW formal distribution, which is equal to A of ZW. Minus the right hand side of 5, where Cj are given by 6. Now one immediately check that just by construction, that the residue of B of ZW Z minus W to the J DZ is zero for all non-negative J. Hence, B of ZW is of the form z to the n bn of w, where bn of w are formal distributions in one variable. But then, since b of zw is also local, because it's a difference of two local formal distributions, and we deduce that B of ZW is equal to zero. Because it has this form, and then it cannot be a zero divisor. Therefore, we know that BZW multiplied by some power Z minus W to the n is zero. But since it's not a zero divisor, we can cancel Z minus W and get that BZW. So this is basically. All right, finally, so we will use this decomposition theorem. And also along the way I introduce a useful notion of the delta function and its properties. Now I can construct the, using the extension theorem, the the first examples of non-commutative vertex. The first example is what's usually called free boson. The space of the of this vertex algebra is naturally denoted by B. It's a vector space of polynomials in infinitely many variables. X1, X2. Okay, now let's look at data of the extension theorem. So you have to introduce vector space, which you will introduce the vacuum vector, which naturally equals 1, and the translation operator, which is, and it will be in the second clear where we take this operator. It is some J greater or equal than 2, Jx, J, D, or D, or J minus 1. And we have to introduce the collection of quantum fields, which will consist just of one quantum field, denoted by which actually it's called the free boson. This quantum here. Which is the following n and z. So I will draw parentheses, just write like this. Minus this one. Where Kn is the operator of partial derivation. And An for n negative is multiplication with minus sign, minus sign xn. For n negative. And A0 equals 2. Then, of course, it is straightforward to check that the commutator of An with An is equal to n delta n minus n for all n n. Ah, yeah, I forgot to say one thing, I don't know how I missed it. Yeah, I forgot to add one remark. Let me put it here. If we have a local pair, A of Z, B of Z, or form distribution in one variable, with coefficient in a Lie algebra of superalgebra. Yeah, probably too much. A G is a Lie algebra. Or superalgebra. Meaning that Z minus W N A D A Z D W is equal to zero. Then by decomposition theorem. Of course, this commutator can be viewed as a form distribution in two variables. Therefore, A of Z D of W commutator can be written as a finite sum of some formal distributions, which I will denote by A of W sub J D of W. Times the jth derivative of the delta function divided by j function. Before we were denoting it by cj of w, but this is a convenient notation. So here a of w J B of W is another formal distribution in one variable. Which is equal according to formula 6 is equal to residue Z minus W to the J Z of W and GC. But now this formula and the formula for the delta function, where is it? Yeah, this one, formula 4. Using 4 and comparing coefficients of z to the n, w to the n. So take this formula, put here instead of derivative the expression for the series expression for the delta function and compare the coefficients. Then we get formula which is what? 7, I suppose. That commutator of AN with BN is equal to sum J greater or equal than 0 M of J AJB. It's a field which is this one. Times the subscript M plus N minus J. So if you write down this thing coefficient wise, you get the following formula for the commutator of arbitrary Fourier coefficients AN, BN. In terms of Fourier coefficients of J's products. Yeah, this is called J's product of formulas. This is a useful formula which will be used, which if I have not too much. All right, but now using this formula 7, we know that any commutator formula, or at least some commutator formulas, are equivalent to decomposition of commutator of two fields in terms of delta function. And in this particular case, this is exactly the same as to say that A of Z is B of W commutator is just equal to the derivative of the delta function. And therefore, z minus w square a of z w square, a of w.
So,
a is local with itself.
What is a n for negative n is what?
Sorry?
A n for negative n.
Yes, is equal minus n xn, right?
But xn for negative n doesn't exist.
Ah. Yeah, maybe I should write it. Yeah, this is correct. Okay. Okay, now let us check conditions. The extension theorem. First, t applied to derivative of 1 is 0. Where is our t? It's hidden. Second, translation covariance. So for that, you have to check that commutator of our t with an is equal to minus a n minus 1 for all n. This is you have to check direct. Next, locality we just proved. Just one field which local to itself. And the completeness is obvious because A minus N is after a constant multiplication by Xn. So you get any, you can get any monomial by applying it, this kind of things many times. Completeness of orders. So by extension theorem, V that B carries a structure of vertex algebra which extends this data. So this is construction of the free boson. Okay, let me take a few minutes. Unfortunately, I don't have time to construct all examples, but at least one other which shows why super is important. Let me now construct free theorem. So the vertex algebra is a Grassmann algebra which usually denoted like that in infinitely many variables. So xi I xi j equals to negative xi j xi I. Vacuum vector value 1. Translation operator, I ask writers to check whether because today I wrote it down, but I'm not 100% sure that it's true. J, psi, j plus 1, u and d, psi, j. I don't know, everybody knows what is derivative for the, in the Grassmann algebra. It is this, that if you take u and d psi j, or something, is zero if psi j doesn't occur. But if it does occur, it appears only to the first power, and you move it to the very left position by using this computational relation. And then u and d xi j of this is equal to Sorry? Yes, now the last data is the collection of fields, which consists just of one fermionic field, some M phi M z to the minus M minus 1, where phi Ns are odd operators. Is equal to d over d psi n plus 1 if n is greater or equal than 0. And phi minus n is equal to multiplication by psi n if n is greater or equal than 1. Then one checks that the commutator of phi m is phi m. Since this is odd operator, then by definition it is phi m minus phi m, plus phi m. Okay? Remember, commutator for two odd, you have change of sign. Is equal to delta m minus n minus 1. But then if you take commutator of the field, rather super commutator, you get just some z to the minus n minus 1 w to the m, n of the c, which is exactly the delta function. You know? Therefore, have locality. And the only completeness is obvious. The only non-trivial thing is to check, and this is an exercise. In particular, you check this, what I wrote is correct. You have to check that t is phi n is equal to minus n phi n minus 1 for L. So all assumptions of the extension theorem hold, therefore this data can be extended canonically to the structure of a vertex algebra, which holds the vertex algebra of the free field. Okay, next time I will give the remaining examples, mainly Virasoro and Affine and Clifford vertex algebras, and after that I will prove the extension theorem and maybe say something else if I have time. Thank you. Yeah, any questions?
Sorry, what did you write in the corner?
Is how to define partial derivative of...
Yes, the first line?
First line is... If you have a polynomial which doesn't involve variable psi, then of course partial derivative is zero. If it does, then you move it to the left and partial derivative.
And excuse me. When you proved the composition theorem, at some point you made an argument to deduce that this B is equal to zero just by taking some residues and then expressing it as a double distribution as just a distribution of one variable, and at some point I kind of missed the point. You defined at some point B of Z, B equal of A, Z
say W minus...
Yeah, we subtract the kind of right-hand side, and we want to prove that it is zero.
Okay, and the argument is...
For that, the argument is the following. First of all, you check, and it's instantly checked using properties of the delta function. Then when you multiply B of CW by any power of C minus W, you get zero.
Okay.
But then, what does it mean? It means that B of ZW involves only non-negative powers of Z. So it's some Z to the N,
okay.
Bn of W for n greater or equal than zero. On the other hand, B of ZW is also local because it's the difference of two local formal distributions. So you get the sum for n greater or equal to zero, z to the n times z minus w to some power is equal to zero. Then you can cancel z minus w to the n.
Okay.
Because a series which goes only in one direction is never zero divisor.
Okay.
It's very clear. Therefore, b of zw. Any other questions?
I have a question. Is there any kind of geometry I should think of when you, because, I mean, it's so, everything very else right. Is there something I should, I don't know, I can keep in mind to help me? I don't know.
Yeah, first of all, of course, it's very algebraized quantum field theory. On the other hand, usually all these operators are not really convergent, so you really have to talk about formal distribution. On the other hand, the geometric pictures which are associated with it will be appear in huge quantities in the lectures of Malikov,
okay.
For example, and also probably to some extent in the lectures of Arakawa. So you will see, Jerry, don't worry.
I'll try to see.